weekend.
Yes, yes.
Praise the Lord. Well, welcome to Spiritual Conversations with Secular People. Let me just tell you a little bit about our keynote speaker and some of his experience. Can't hear me?
Can we pull this out?
Looks like it's wired in.
Okay. 1, 2, 3. Is that coming through? Is that any better?
Yeah, it's okay.
Let's see. Genius. Here we go. Well, it's a real privilege to welcome you all here today. I'm getting shoved around. That's all right. Our keynote speaker today is somebody who's well known to us all if you've been coming along to these meetings for a while. It's a real privilege to introduce him. Tom has currently been working in the United States as the with NADI.
That's the North American Institute
for Evangelism, Church Planting, all kinds of exciting things to spread the gospel around the world. And Tom's also spent a year living in Australia before, so he knows a bit about our culture. As a young man who was a youth director, youth pastor?
Youth director in South New South Wales, Canberra.
South New South Wales, youth director for the year. So he's told me that he was friends with a guy who got drunk and stuck his hand down a snake hole and got bitten by a snake. And then he got the antidote from the doctors and then came back the next week with the same condition. And so this is the kind of friends that he's used to making when he's hanging out.
Qualifies me to teach the seminar, right?
Sure, he wasn't American.
Oh, thanks a lot. Maybe a Kiwi, right?
Anyway, it's a real privilege to welcome Tom. He's not only somebody who's good at administrative leadership, but he's a guy who really believes in spreading the gospel personally. And, you know, the time I've spent with Tom, I've been so encouraged to see him as we've interacted with someone in a shop or something like that, talk about sharing the gospel with that person right then and there. And so we're in for a real treat this afternoon, so let's put our hands together and give a warm Australian welcome.
And I have to say, I appreciate the emphasis on warm, because we live in Michigan. And it is very cold this time of year. So we've been looking forward to this 3 weeks. Our family will be here. My wife and two boys are here with me. And we have, you know, some things we're doing with church planters, actually, on Monday, Tuesday morning. And so I have an interest sheet here to pass around. If you have an interest in church planting, this is your church planting coordinator right here for your conference. And I believe the gospel spreads most rapidly when we start new things. And when we start new things, we reach new people. And people get very passionate about what they're doing and want to invite people to come to their church. You know, I believe the best way to spread the gospel is by word of mouth. In other words, it's not by hiring a mailman to deliver brochures in somebody's post box, right? It's by us being so excited about our experience with God and about the church that we go to that we can't help but share it. And I'm around, you know, I was talking with somebody just the other day. They were, you know, talking about how, you know, so many churches are going down and there's not enthusiasm in the church. I said, you know, I just hang around with a different crowd. When I'm involved with church planting, these are people that believe God can do great things, that see God doing great things. They're an exciting bunch to work with. So I see the best of Adventism in the job that I have. And I see our church on the move. I see exciting things happening. And when I see what's happening here, this weekend, it is exciting to me to see pastors and church leaders coming together and saying, hey, let's come together for the sake of the gospel to see this keep going forward. So anyway, if you'd like to learn more about church planting, we'll just pass this around. Just jot your name and a few details down there, and Pastor Ben will be in touch with you. But let's bow our heads for a word of prayer as we begin. Dear Lord, we're going to be looking at an important topic of how to connect with people who are secular, people who don't have you on their mind. And Lord, we want to be able to engage in those conversations in a way that will draw people to you. So Lord, please give us wisdom, give us ideas, insights. And I want to pray for each person here that this coming week, they'll immediately be able to apply something that they learned here today and connect with somebody for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let me share with you, first of all, something our family personally is doing to connect with a couple of young boys that are very, very secular. These are two boys, Lucas and JJ. This is my wife, Mara. She has a lot less hair now. She trimmed some off for the winter. I don't know why. It's the opposite way around. I guess because we're coming to Australia, right? But we are adopting two boys from Latvia. Have any of you ever been to Latvia before? Look at that. That is unusual. What took you to Latvia? And you took in Latvia. Look at that. Yeah, not a lot of tourists make it that direction. There's some beautiful places. But these two boys, Andris and Daniels, are from an orphanage in Latvia. And last Christmas for 4 weeks, this Christmas for 4 weeks, and 8 weeks during the summer, they've come and lived in our home. And we found out that they don't know about God. That has not been part of their experience. And so we're able to have conversations with these two young boys about spiritual things. And when they first arrive, the middle finger is frequently shown. My wife has been spit on. My mother who lives with us has been peed on. But this is all part of, you know, and it all just kind of starts to drop off the more time that they stay. And yeah. So it's been a blessing to see how they've responded to spiritual things. Family worship. You know, the guy up here, Daniels, he'll be the one say, hey, we need to have worship. You know, and so, and prayer for the meal. I mean, they've just started to, you know, to incorporate all this in their lives. So we hope by this summer, summer in the U.S., that they'll be adopted. So that's, anyway, so we have firsthand experience with our own children now, adopting these two boys of connecting with completely secular people. In fact, the younger boy, we were sitting at Pioneer Memorial Church, and somebody's singing special music, and he asked if that was Jesus singing special music. I mean, they have no idea. It just is not going to be. If they stay there, this God would not be part of their lives, right? I want to share one story, and Ben asked if I could share this because it's just so remarkable to see what God can do with somebody who's willing to be used by Him. This particular individual, I had a ministerial director in the Alberta conference. I was there doing some training with pastors, and he approached me and said, Tom, how would you like to hear about the top soul winner in our conference? And I was working hiring pastors for Texas, so I'm like, I can't believe this guy's just going to share with me. I was ready to get the email, the phone number. You know how it goes, right? We're looking for good pastors all the time. And he started to laugh. He says, not one of our pastors. And I said, oh, that's, I still want to hear about it. He said, it's a lay person. And not only a lay person, this is a lady that has a stuttering problem. This lady, this simple lady, and I'll show you a picture right here, Faye Mullins has a stuttering problem, and she's brought over 250 people into the Seventh-day Adventist Church in the very secular province of Alberta in Canada. How does Faye bring these people into church? She has spiritual conversations with secular people in the grocery store. That's it. Almost everybody she's brought into the church, she's met in the grocery store. Her faith just exudes from her. She invites them to her home to come and study the Bible. But the key is to have a meal, right? Let's have a meal together and come. And probably she cooks some good Jamaican food for them, man. Yeah, man, no problem. That Irie, man. Yeah? So she makes them some nice Jamaican food, studies the Bible with them. Several months later, they get baptized. A couple years ago, she planted her first church. So her numbers are far beyond 250 now. That's when I first heard about it. But it's exciting to see. And Faye Mullins taught me something very important. A couple things, really. God uses humble people. If you're proud, if you think you're good, if you think you have all the techniques, God will make sure that you learn how to depend on Him, right? And so sometimes being talented is actually a detriment to God's work because God is the one that needs to get the glory, right? Are we together on that? The second one is God can use anybody that He wants. Who are you? Who am I to say that, oh, that person doesn't have much potential as a witness for Jesus? We can't say that. I imagine, Pastor Ben, if you showed up to your church and this sweet lady comes out and said, Pastor, great sermon. I don't think Pastor Ben or me in our minds would think this is going to be the top soul winner in our church. Not only that, it's going to be the top soul winner in our whole conference. And yet God because she is willing, has used her in a powerful way. So I'm going to share with you some of my favorite approaches in conversing with secular people. Some of you have other approaches that you've used that you like. Some of you are very experienced in this type of thing. And I hope to give you one new idea that you haven't heard of before. Maybe you've tried it, but you hadn't put your finger on it and said, you know what? That's a method that can be used to connect with secular people. So I'm going to share one idea, I think, that will be brand new for all of you. In fact, I had one of my students, I shared this in class, and he texted me a couple months after he'd been out pastoring. He said, you know that idea you shared in class? It works. And so I thought, you know, it does. I know it does because I've used it consistently. But I hope you get a new idea as well for those of you that are quite experienced in having these kind of conversations. I think Ben shared last night that I'm a fifth generation Adventist. And as a result, these things did not come to me naturally. I grew up in an Adventist community. Being around secular people was not something that I did a lot of. You live in a country that is full of a lot of secular people, right? The majority of Australia is very secular. Personally, I love a lot about Australian culture. I keep, I've been working on my wife ever since we've been married, saying we need to move to Australia, we need to move to Australia. You know, because I love the time I worked here. As he shared, my best friend while I was here, you know, he struggled in and out of the church. He's really struggled. And we're still friends today. I met his wife. He went through a divorce. They got back together for a while. Then they really finished things off, and now he's with another lady. I met her for the first time, and she said that Phil is the first man that she's ever dated. But she had a relationship with two women that she lived together with for 5-6 years each. This is life in Australia, isn't it? These are the kind of people that we need to know how to converse with. And you sit there and as you listen to this lady, and what she's felt from the people that she's met from the church is a judgment on her. And I know that's what she's felt. And are my wife and I going to be able to communicate in a way that she thinks well of us and as a result thinks well of the God that we serve, right? That's a challenge. And so, you know, this friend, yeah, he did stick his hand down and got bit when he was drunk, you know, by a snake. And goes in, he actually had it latched to him when he ran to the hospital because he wanted him to see what kind of snake it was. And so he runs in the door there and everybody's scattering. And they say, kill the snake and then we'll see you. But he had the blood coming out and everything. And when he got bit a couple weeks later, they said the only reason he survived is because he still had anti-venom in his system from the previous snake bite. So they said if he gets bit again, he's done. It's over. But, you know, he's somebody that, you know, when we're here, we'll go see him. We'll go stay at their house, you know, if we're able to do that in our schedule. So anyway, it's exciting to interact with people in this way that are open, even though they don't know they're open. But when you can touch the heart through the way you converse with them, God can open a lot of doors. So, I believe that we like to, in many places in Adventism, we like to pay the postman to do evangelism for us. Because we forgot how to be friends with unchurched people. And so the only thing we can come up with is we need to mail out some Bible study cards. Maybe we need to go knocking door to door cold turkey, and there's a place for that, okay? I'm not saying we can't do that. I'm not saying we should never mail brochures. But if our members, if we as pastors could learn simply how to be friends with unchurched people, how to connect with them, I believe this is the best way to grow God's church. This is the way we really, and it doesn't cost anything. It's just simply being, you know, it's easy to be friends among ourselves, right? And friends with those that already believe, the holy huddle, right? It's another thing to step outside of that and to be friends with somebody who doesn't know Jesus. And yet that's what we're called to do, isn't it? Fellowship in the church is not why we exist as a church, right? There's going to be fellowship in heaven. Food in the church is not why the church exists, so we can have good fellowship meals, right? We're going to have fellowship meal in heaven, right? Beautiful music. Wow, I loved, to me, the highlight of the weekend so far was the special music at the end of church. That was absolutely beautiful. But I can tell you, if I go and speak with the singer, she'll say that it didn't go quite as she hoped, right? Singers always say that. Musicians are very particular. But the church does not exist because we enjoy listening to good music. We're a part of a rescue mission. That's why we exist. And so that's what we need to be about the business of doing. It's not just so we can come strengthen each other as believers. We need that. But we need to be always thinking outside of ourselves and outside of our community. All right, moving quickly here. When I fly, this is my preferred approach, okay? Not to lean my shoulder on the lady next to me, but I do like to sleep on the airplane. And it's a great time to get caught up. This time I had three seats all to myself. It was so nice. I laid down and slept, but I did have a nice conversation with the young lady across the row from me. We talked for a while. And so I've come to, you know, make it a natural thing for me to be able to have these kind of conversations with people. Sometimes it goes a spiritual direction, sometimes it doesn't. But my hope is if God wants to give me that opportunity, I'm willing and ready, right? And the question is, how much do we share and what do we share and what's appropriate? That's a whole other topic, and we will touch on that briefly, because sometimes we can turn a fire hydrant hose on, right? And we can drown somebody and they're not interested. We need to share enough to interest them, right? But do it in an appropriate way. So on this particular flight, I was flying from Chicago to Minneapolis. And it's not a long flight, about a 90-minute flight that I was on. And as I, you know, you kind of scope out where you're going to sit and who's going to be next to you, right? And wonder, am I going to get a nap, or is this going to be somebody who wants to talk the whole time? Well, this guy, you know, shook my hand as I took the seat. I mean, he was ready to talk. And I found out a lot of things about him in the first few minutes of our conversation. 27 years old, a single guy beginning his accounting career, and he's headed out for a guy's weekend. So, question. I don't know what guy's weekends are like in Australia, but it might be kind of similar as the way they are in America. What happens on a guy's weekend? Let's see what you know about that. Drinking, okay, what else? Fishing could be. In America, it's probably more sports, right? And maybe here too?
Pizza, shooting,
okay. There may be some women involved too, okay? I mean, this is a guy's weekend. They're gonna party it up. And he's looking forward to this. Do you think there's a chance that I could dissuade him from his guy's weekend? Should that be my objective in this conversation? Now, we're not going to go very far that way, right? That's not the starting point. We're agreed on that one, right? So, he shares with me that there's some jokes that he wouldn't laugh at if he was serious. Now, he offered that information to me. That's pretty interesting, isn't it? There's some jokes that I wouldn't laugh at. What did he mean if I was serious? What does that mean? So, as we have conversations with secular folk, we need to have a curious mind, right? We need to be listening with curiosity. Because that will help us by using their own words when we talk with them. That is one of the ways that we can begin to connect. Well, you said that, you know, you would, if you were more serious, that you wouldn't laugh at some jokes. What did you mean by being more serious? What did that mean? Do you see where that starts to go? I'm not preaching at him at all. I'm just asking him about something he said, right? He grew up in a broken home. There's another interesting piece of information, right? And he thinks it's strange that his current girlfriend is a committed Christian, as was his last girlfriend. So here's a completely secular guy, but somehow he's dating Christian girls. That's another interesting piece of information. So, what approach do I take? Do I want to help this man learn some truth regarding the 28 fundamental beliefs? Maybe eventually, but not right now, right? That's not where we need to head first. Yeah, you know, I love being a Seventh-day Adventist, and like I said, I'm a fifth-generation Seventh-day Adventist. I think sometimes, at least in the States, we seem to be more in love with the Sabbath than we are with the Lord of the Sabbath. And we just think that we've got to share with people the good news about the Sabbath, because that's truth that they haven't heard. Here's a totally secular guy. He doesn't even know Jesus. I think it's more important that he finds Jesus first than he finds the Sabbath. We need to get there eventually. But we love our doctrine so much, and many of us came into the church because the truth was the thing that drew us, right? And yet, that's not the place to always start, right? We need to have wisdom in how we approach people. So do I need to share with him the Sabbath because he needs rest? No. Or how about this one? Helping him find a Seventh-day Adventist church near where he lives. Is that the place to start? Now, we're talking about one thing, spiritual conversations, but we're also talking about what's appropriate. Where do we start, right? Not there yet. How about this one? Do you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? Helping him give up drinking. No? We're not going to go there? Okay. So, I had to learn this lesson the hard way because, you know, I get very passionate about things and I'm passionate about what I believe. And I remember 19 years old, I was on an airplane flying over to England to go to school at Newbold. And I happened to have a seat right by a Catholic priest. You know, he has a little collar on, you can see it. I was so excited. I mean, here's a captive audience for like 8 hours, right? And so in my mind, I'm thinking, which doctrine do I start with? Which one do I want to, you know, bring new light to this man of the cloth, right? And so I finally settled on the state of the dead. So I began this discourse and scriptural evidences on the state of the dead. And the man reached up and rang a little, you know, the little bell above the, you know, the light and called for the lady to come. And when she arrived, he said, ma'am, could you help relocate me to a different seat? So I had to learn. Again, I'm fifth generation Adventist. I don't know how to do this stuff, right? I know I'm passionate about what I believe, but the approach is important, isn't it? How we approach folks. So here's a 90-minute flight. I'm going to give you a chance to do a little case study here. Jay wants to talk, okay? I'm not going to be getting a nap. You won't be getting a nap in this conversation. What approach should be taken with Jay? Let's start there. Take a couple minutes, groups of three or four. What approach are you going to take with Jay? And then we'll move to the next question after that. So what approach do you take with Jay? You've got 90-minute flight. He seems to want to talk. Is this a chance for a spiritual conversation? If so, what approach will you take? Go ahead, groups of three or four. Oh, yeah. This one? Okay. Okay, let's come back together if we can. I'd like to hear the feedback maybe from three or four people. Where'd you like to start? It's a good dialogue. Where are we going to start? Start with the broken home, somebody says. Okay, good.
We talked about that, but we reckon the wedge in is the girlfriend of the Christian.
Okay, the Christian girlfriend. How many like that approach? Okay, that's an open door, isn't it? Yeah, very, very good approach there, starting with the girlfriend. The broken home's another possibility. What's another possibility from what he shared with us? Okay, connecting with what kind of funny. And so we could have, might have, maybe connect an area of common interest, perhaps. That's a very common approach some people use. It's not one of the four I'm going to be sharing with you this afternoon. That's one we kind of all are aware of, right? Yes? Okay, yeah, so we could go back to the seriousness with the jokes and what it would look like to be serious, yeah?
God's trying to get a message to him. He's giving him two Christian girlfriends.
Okay. Either that or Christian girls are more pure and he's more interested in that, you know?
Yeah, I thought, ask him why he felt attracted to two Christian girls in a row.
Oh, yeah, very good. Ask them why. Why he was attracted to two Christian girls in a row. Yeah. Must not have been too bad experience the first time, right? It's up for it again. Okay, at the club. No, let's hope not, right? Let's hope not. Christian in name only, not in practice, right? We don't know. We don't know that much. What kind of Christian girls are they? We don't know. You know, do they just say they're Christians, or are they actually, you know, living it? Do they go to church? We don't know those things. Did you have a comment?
I think it's very important to listen more. Ask a short question about something he said and let him expand on it.
Do a little bit more listening first.
Try and guide him into
okay.
Where he's going with his thoughts.
Okay. So here's a very interesting concept. How many think that we want to guide him? We have an agenda we want to guide him on. Okay. It's an interesting thought. If we have, you know, this comes to the second question we had here, and we need to get back to this one. In a moment here, what do you hope will be the outcome of the conversation? And if we want to guide him a certain direction, then we have an outcome in mind, right? Mm. Yep, so we need to know what that is.
Well, we've got the questions to keep him talking.
Yep, okay, good. You want to keep it brief, yeah. Listen for a while longer. Okay, was there one more? Is it back? Yeah, go ahead.
You want to start, you have to be very open-ended in the way you approach this guy. If you start asking him direct questions, he is going to clam up so quick.
Okay, we don't want to get him to shut down in any whatever we do. Open it, keep it open, keep him talking.
So we have to be, he has to feel that we're genuine about his, our interest in him. He has to feel that.
Okay.
For him to gain confidence.
It really comes back to the point of having the curiosity,
yeah.
Having the interest in the person.
Yes.
This young lady I was just sitting by on the airplane, she was going to stay with her sister in New Zealand. That's where we were flying into Auckland. She was going to go stay with her sister. And she thought many times about moving to New Zealand. So I said, what would hinder you from doing that? That's taking an interest in her.
Yeah.
Well, I'm in a lot of student debt. Well, and so we talk some more, you know. Yeah. But very interesting. It's taking interest in what she's saying.
Yeah.
And in this case, what he would be saying. Any more comments? Yes.
We want to know what he felt, why the girls were attracted to him. Why two Christian girls were attracted?
Oh, okay. That's kind of turning our head a little bit, isn't it? Why the girls are interested in him.
Absolutely.
Rather than him and interest in the girls. Okay, let's move to this next question. Again, take about 3 minutes. What do you hope will be the outcome of the conversation? When we got off the plane 90 minutes later, what do we hope will have happened? Okay, go ahead and discuss that for about 3 minutes together. Haven't figured out?
There's a question here, Tom.
Mm-hmm.
Sitting next to someone like that, does it help, or is it a barrier to tell them
that I'm a minister. Because it happened.
What's your hunch?
It happened to me.
Okay. And did you tell them?
When we were having this good conversation, it froze on. And but the minute I told him that I'm a St. Patrick's minister, the conversation
yeah. Yeah. So the question is, what's the right timing to do it if you should do it? Yeah. No, that's good. Good question. Okay, let's come back together again. All right. Okay, what's the outcome? What do we hope to accomplish after 90 minutes? What'd you come up with?
Baptism.
Okay, very good. Baptism and a wedding, right? Why not? Okay, you want to leave him with something to think about.
Yes.
Thinking about his life in a deeper level, okay? Do we want anything more tangible than that, or is that tangible enough? Sorry, what? Some kind of contact for follow-up, okay? So always have something with you that's appropriate that you can share, okay?
You may not get that opportunity, but I think the main thing is to actually, what I would hope for is that we've given him enough to think about.
Okay.
And that gives the Holy Spirit the tools he needs to be able to reach that person in the mind. I'm sitting here through prayer, intercessory prayer. And
okay.
If my idea would be, yeah, great idea, get his contact number. But I think that what we need is to make sure that when we go back, we let the church know. I've been talking to this young fellow, and he showed a type of interest. We need to pray for this guy.
Okay, all right.
Because
so,
it's the Holy Spirit. We're not
right.
Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit.
Right. Yeah, the Holy Spirit converts. We have to prepare the soil. We have a responsibility to prepare. So if we approach him the wrong way, we're going to mess up the soil, aren't we? But so we want to prepare soil that will be something the Holy Spirit will really work with. I think I saw over here. Yes.
I think if we have an idea of what we want to leave with or we leave, I think it's presumption, because I think we need to be really praying at the time. What does that person need? And I think the main thing we need to leave with them is the impression that we're a loving and lovable Christian and that they don't get turned off by that we've put something in their hand.
Okay.
Good.
Very good. There's a verse I'll share at the end of our time together that indicates that we need to know how to respond to each person individually. There's not one prescribed way. In other words, this conversation needs to be Holy Spirit guided. That needs to undergird whatever we're doing. We can't have one prescribed approach. The Bible tells us you need to know how to respond to each individual. As a situation would demand. And of course, presenting a loving and lovable Christian is one of the best things that we can do, for sure. Okay, I think over here, let's get some hands that were over there in the back. Okay, we're good there? Okay,
it's
yes.
About trust.
Okay.
They need to be able to trust me in exchanging our contact details. If they have a question, they need to be able to trust us with perhaps some more information.
How do people learn to trust somebody in a brief conversation like this? Trust is usually built over time, right? Yep. There can be enough trust developed. We will touch on that later. We're going to get to how secular people will trust you. We're going to get to that moment in a little bit because it's very important. Okay. Yeah, good. Yeah, and that really kind of touches where we'll go with it, but we'll get there in a minute. Yes.
If you're an Aussie, you're sharing a drink and that builds trust.
There we go.
But seriously, I would try and tell him as a story that God loves him and that God has a plan for his life, and I don't know what that plan is, but I know that God loves him, and I would say to him, I wonder if God has been trying to reach out to you through
okay.
Two young ladies, and that's just a question.
So one goal would be to share some kind of a testimonial type of way that God has a plan for him. Okay? Very good. And many people say, you know, we need to always be looking for an opportunity to share our personal testimony. I think there's evidences in Scripture that there are places where that needs to happen. This wasn't the approach I took with this young man, and I'll share why in a moment. Okay, yes. Yeah, so we've got to be dialed into him in the way that we're talking. Okay, last one here.
And that's where it comes to listening. To be a listener.
Yeah.
This guy wants to talk.
Yeah.
And if he sees that you're listening to him, not criticizing or you know, sometimes that for a person, that's all they need.
Yeah. Good. Listening is a way to build trust. Okay. Here's what I decided to do. I teach a class for pastors, I teach at the seminary, on coaching. And how, you know, helping, you know, as we coach individuals, as we use this approach of coaching. And I'll just touch on it a little bit. But we're on Sunday afternoon and Monday and Tuesday morning, we're going to be doing some coach training. I think it's open to anybody, isn't it, that would like to come?
If you get your name on there, you got a chance for it.
But I had never tried this approach with secular people, which is... Let's go back up this way. We're good. Everybody's got it. If you haven't got it, you can come see Ben afterwards. So this coaching approach I use to help people kind of, you know, discover God's will for their life, where, you know, God is leading them to help, you know, focus and ministry, these kind of things. Many times I use it in this way. I had even used it on a marriage counseling situation where I actually was coaching a couple that were having marriage problems. They've been to many counselors before. And they basically resolved their own problem by me asking them questions, right? And causing them to think about it. So I decided to use coaching with this guy. And that means I'm going to be asking open-ended, hopefully powerful questions. By powerful, I mean that they make him think, right? But those questions have to be based on what he is saying, not on some agenda that I have for him. Because that is the nature of coaching. Coaching, the person you're talking to is setting the agenda, not you, right? So I'm going to let him set the agenda. Then I'm going to see what kind of goals that he wants to set for his life, all right? And then this is the goal of the conversation, where I want to go with it, helping him identify the next steps toward where he wants to be in his life, okay? So he's going to have something very tangible, two or three things that he can do as a result of the conversation based on decisions he's making, not on what I'm telling him he needs to do. So here's some questions I ask him. And you were right onto it, right up here. I think somebody was mentioning about the girlfriends, right? Yep. So here it is. Why do you think you keep finding Christian girls to date? So we're going to start with that as the entering wedge. It's something he said. It's something I'm not implying in a situation using what he's told me. Where would you like to be in your life spiritually? Now, why is that a fair question to ask? He's dating Christian girls, right? It's an open door. He says, you know, he could easily tell me. There's an option he could tell me, I have no interest in that. I just like these girls, right? I'm not pigeonholing him, saying that he has to answer it in the positive or affirmative. I'm simply asking where he would like to be. So can you imagine what he said to me here? I was so happy with this response. He said, this is where I'm at right now. This is where I'd like to be. So what's the next obvious question? What would it take to go from here to there, right? Very simple. You know, God's giving the opportunity right here, and I just have to ask the questions, right? He said, well, I think, he paused for a bit, and he said, I think, and by the way, when you're coaching, you ask these kind of questions, you don't have to repeat the question. If they didn't understand you, they'll ask you to clarify, right? We try to jump in and fill in the Holy Spirit gaps when we talk with people. The silence is an opportunity for the Holy Spirit to speak to their heart, right? And when somebody's thinking deeply, we don't need to be interrupting with another question, all right? We need to let them think deeply. So this is where I'm at, this is where I want to be. What would it take for you to get there? Pause. I think it would take some kind of crisis to happen in my life. A crisis. I said, Jay, you just told me that it would take a crisis for you to get serious with God. How does that make you feel? Why is that an important question? We need to be dealing with the heart, right? We need to be dealing with heart issues, not just head issues, not just correcting people's thinking, but understanding where their heart is on something. He said, that makes me feel afraid. Here's this big, tough guy, 27 years old, headed into a promising career, dating a girl that he's crazy about, and he's afraid that for God to get a hold of him, he's going to have to have something tragic happen in his life. So we continue the conversation, and we finally came down to the point where I asked him this question: who can help you reach your goal? All right? He has this goal of wanting to get closer to God. What is the chance I'm going to see Jay again? Slim to none, right? Slim to none. Probably not going to happen again. So me being that connecting point for Jay to help him grow spiritually, probably not the best direction to go. Unless somehow we were to make phone call, or he were to request, you know, hey, could you help me? Could I get in touch with you? You know, that'd be fair enough if you want to ask that. So the question, who can help you reach your goal? What do you think his answer is going to be?
Girlfriend.
How many think he's going to say his girlfriend? How many think he's going to say something else? All right. The beautiful thing about coaching is he gets to answer, not me. If it were me giving my opinion to Jay, well, Jay, you want to be closer to God. How about your girlfriend? Could she help you out with that? I'm sure she would enjoy helping you, you know, find Jesus in your life. That would be my advice, right? And that's often what we try to do when we talk with people, is we like to give them advice from our experience. The problem is we only have, each one of us individually have a very narrow scope of experience, right? And so we're prescribing things based on our own experience rather than on something that would fit for them. So by leaving it open-ended, Jay's going to give me his answer, his solution. And Jay says, my mom can help me. I mean, that came out of the blue. Where is this coming from? He said, you know, my mom was far from God. She was away from God, but she's recently come back to God strong. And I think she would be able to help me with that. If I give him my opinion, it might not have worked, right? If it had been the girlfriend advice, it might not have worked. But because he picked it, now it's going to work, right? So I said, when would you like to talk with your mom about helping you with this? He said, I'm going to talk with her as soon as I get back from my guy's weekend. Right? So that was he has a very clear step now. He wants to get closer to God. He's going to talk with his mom about it, and he's going to do it as soon as he gets back. We need to be specific if we want to help somebody find a next step. And one of the ways to nail that down is always to ask them these two questions. Who can help you reach your goal? And when are you going to talk with them? When are you going to start is another way to do it. When would you like to start? And so those are two ways we can help gauge it. Now, I did have to tell Jay one thing, and I stopped my coaching at this point. I said, Jay, you're going to have a guy's weekend this weekend, and a lot of crazy things can happen on a guy's weekend. So I'm going to pray that God will protect you so that when you get back, you can get where you want to be in your life with God. So that's the only thing I told him, simply that I'd be praying for him that God would protect him, you know, on the guy's weekend. Yeah, right. You know, how do you think Jay felt about this conversation? Was he put off? I mean, did he put up any walls? Did I say anything that triggered something or shut him down or anything like this? No, Jay was so excited about this because, you know, I'm helping him move a step or two closer to where he wants to be in his life, a goal that he sets for himself. And so he actually, this is not a picture of Jay here, but these are the exact words that Jay said to me. Thank you for helping me get closer to where I want to be in my life. Jay was so excited, he shook my hand 3 times before we left. Sitting there, getting up, shook my hand again. As we left, he shook my hand again. He was so excited. He made progress to where he wants to be. I helped him clarify those things through coaching. So this is the first point I want to make. Coaching is one of my favorite ways to connect with secular people. Asking questions, listening, let the Holy Spirit guide the conversation, not based on my agenda, not based on something I'm hoping to have come from it, but simply helping them reach goals that they want to set in their lives. And listening for those cues, right? Those pointers that we can, I had 4 different angles we could have taken with Jay. He gave me 4 different ways in to start with my questions. But again, that's where the Holy Spirit needs to let us know where to start and guide that conversation. Okay. Any questions on this first method that we can use? There's some great books on coaching. Coaching's been very popular for many years in the business world. People pay big bucks to have somebody come in from the outside and do some coaching and give that outside perspective, right? But it is a biblical method. By the way, Jesus preferred asking questions to answering questions 2 to 1. When people came to him and asked for his advice, 2 times to 1, he would ask them a question rather than answer it. I'm wondering if that has anything to do with two ears and one mouth. Right? We know that saying, we should listen more than we talk, right? And I'm wondering if we need to be using this approach more when we interact with people inside and outside of the church. When somebody comes and asks for advice, we simply respond by asking a question. What do you think? What's the Holy Spirit impressing you to do? How might this be resolved from your perspective? Very simple. It becomes natural after we start doing it for a while. It took me 10 years to learn how to do it.
If you didn't have that Christian girlfriend to kind of go on.
Yep. Yeah, I believe it's, you know, in most conversations, somebody's going to say something that can be a good connecting point. And I probably would have taken the laughing, the jokes if you were serious and started with that one. That was a really good one, too. What would serious look like to you? I love asking somebody, what would that look like? What would it look like to be where you want to be in your life? Well, I would be going to church. I would be, I wouldn't be drinking so much. They'll begin to paint that picture for you. Well, how are you going to get there? Which one of those is the highest priority for you right now? How would you get there with that? And so, again, we need to learn coaching skills. Some people are naturally wired for it. I thought I knew how to coach, and really hasn't been for, it took 10 years for it to be kind of the first tool I always try to pull out of the tool bag. I mean, I was standing at the line at the GC building, and somebody asked me a question. I said, I can't answer the question. I've got to coach them. Because then they walk away owning. Rather than, oh, Tom just gave me some good advice, they say, wow, I came up with a solution for my problem. There's much more excitement over that. So again, we need to listen to where the Holy Spirit says, that's the one. That's the one to lead in with and start with the questions there and see where it goes. See where God leads with it. And if it doesn't go anywhere, we start with another angle. Yeah.
Now, it's obvious that young man had a background where he actually still believed there was a God. How do you go with a person who is an atheist, confirmed atheist?
Yeah, again, we'd have to take a different approach, but again, we need to listen to what they're saying. And I believe with any person, there's going to be some, Ellen White talks about this key to unlock your neighbor's heart. And the fourth point I'm going to make, I think, is where I'd start with them. Because we're talking about four different approaches that I like. This is one approach. There are three others. So we need to decide which one fits best for the person that we're trying to connect with, right? Sometimes we're going to use all four approaches. I'd use approach number four that we're going to talk with somebody that's completely no belief in God whatsoever. I would rather than the coaching one. Unless in a conversation they triggered by something they said that might open the door that way. But this is, again, every situation we have to be open to how the Holy Spirit is going to tell us to go forward with that conversation. Since you live by the Spirit, you must be in step with the Spirit, Scripture says. We need to be walking right with the Holy Spirit as we enter into these conversations. Yes, let's take one more and then we'll move to point number two.
Prior to talking to the secular people, we have to pray to ourselves first so that the Holy Spirit can give us the thought that we can talk to.
Yeah. And what I would challenge us with is not so much the thought what to say, but what to ask. Right? Because we're going to get a different outcome if we're listening and we're asking. Okay, moving to the next point. I think I have a little video here that the audio is not important to it. Oh, it's signed up. Good. It's in. Okay, shot that with my iPhone, not a professional video. But anybody know where this is at? Australia? No, not Australia. Where?
I said not Australia, there's no glove.
There's no glove. All right, that's interesting. Okay, where would this be?
Mexico.
This is in the country of Trinidad and Tobago. And this is actually called a Trini Double. It actually is a vegetarian. It's made out of chickpeas. And then if you want pepper, you say slight pepper if you just want a little bit. And so anyway, you have to learn the customs and the culture. And my second favorite approach, I'm sharing four here, is to connect with secular people via culture, via their culture. All right? this is actually my first preferred approach that I'll usually start with, is trying to connect with culture and taking a real interest in that person's culture. So I was teaching a class in Trinidad for a couple weeks on church planting, and had a number of pastors that were attending, and in order to connect with my students, I want to connect with their culture, right? So I found out that there's certain foods that are, you know, well loved in Trinidad. Doubles, Trini doubles being one of them, which this is called a Trini double, I guess because they put two tortillas down and then they put the stuff on top. A little bit messy to eat. People lined up at these street carts that sell these particular goods. Another one is called roti. It's another food that they absolutely love. So to connect with culture, I need to connect with the food of that culture, right? That is a great way to connect. I see you nodding your head. Where do you originally, where's your family from, I should say? Yes, sure.
God just put a word in my mouth what I say.
So do you have a Chinese background then?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so you speak Mandarin?
Mandarin.
Yes.
And Korean.
And Korean. Yeah. Very nice. My son, Lucas, some of you will see him here, he speaks now English, Portuguese, Russian. The next one is going to be Mandarin.
Okay.
That's what we're talking about. That'll be the next one, but we probably have to adopt a Chinese girl to be able to get the, so you can practice enough. But you know, people love when you connect and show an interest in their culture. And so I went down to the street there and got in line and ate the food that they had there, enjoyed it. And then I went and found this malt drink that they have in the store. It's, you know, it was non-alcoholic. And I'm drinking their malt drink, eating their food. I buy some extra malt drinks, bring back to the associate dean of the seminary, who's from Trinidad. Have it sit one of those bottles on his desk because he's out of you know, town at the moment. He comes back. Can you imagine his excitement to see from his country somebody showing an interest in him and his culture? But then I found out also these guys like to play cricket, right? You guys like cricket here. In fact, you guys have the most famous Sir... Yeah, Bradman. And yeah, and almost perfect, wasn't he? He got like the scoring that was...
He would have done if he didn't get a duck in the last game.
Yeah, I mean, so yes, Sir Donald Bradman, right? Yeah, amazing. And you have to center the ball? You center the ball? No, what do you do with the ball? You have to... I know, but when you want to get it over the fence? A six, but what do you do with the middle of the ball? Yeah, you have to middle the ball, right? No? You don't want to middle the ball. For us in American baseball, we want to hit the sweet spot, right? That's where you want to hit the sweet spot on the bat, you know, so you have the most control there. But I went outside and decided to play cricket with these guys, right? And I'm coming from an American baseball. We hold completely different, you know, but I have a cricket set at my house that I bought here in Australia. And when we have our church planters come together and Ben was there, we go out inside and we play cricket. That's what we play in our backyard. Because culture is important when we want to connect with people, right? And we need to broaden our experiences that way as much as we can. So here I am playing cricket with these guys, and somebody hits the ball, and I went like this and caught it. Unbelievable. I couldn't believe it. Man, you should have seen these students. They were giving high fives to each other and laughing and having a great time. So then I find out that the steel drum is something that is like for their island. This is like their country. This is like the musical instrument. Found out one of my students was really good at steel drum. So I said, come play your steel drum for class. And here's the teacher. Now I'm videoing him playing the steel drum. They wouldn't be coming back to Trinidad. Why? Is it because, you know, the teaching was so? Because I took an interest in them, right? And this is what we need to learn to do with secular people. When we connect with their culture, this is their heart. This is the language of their heart. This is the thing that connects with them the most. And we were just over here at the church. And there was a lady that one of the pastors introduced us. This lady's from Brazil. So I don't know much Portuguese, but I said, tudo bem. And she lit up immediately. Then my wife started saying, he doesn't speak Portuguese. Anyway, but you know, the culture connection right away, right? Food is a great way to do it. If you don't know the language at all, food is a great way to do it. places you've traveled, people you know. All these things are a great way to connect with other people. Now, some of you may live in communities that are pretty much monocultural. And so that's your connection can still be in the culture. Where's your family from? Where did you grow up? Where did you live? These things people really feel passionate about. One thing I love about Australia, and first thing we did, we got back from the airport, we went and had some fish and chips, but Barramundi. Barramundi. I said Mundi instead of Monday. Barramundi. We had Barramundian chips. That's different than fish and chips, isn't it? Because that's a cod. That's good, right? I'm a vegan that eats fish. Sorry. But I do, as Jesus did after he's resurrected. Anyway.
You can have
Barra
Tuesday as well if you want one.
Yeah, there you go. But one of the first things I did is I went and found some mongrel boots. Man, those things are good. If you don't have them as Australians, man, you need to be wearing those mongrel boots. Or the redback ones. So my wife has a redback pair. I have some of the, you know, the, I'm blanking on the mongrel ones. They have some mongrel ones. So, but I had these pans I needed to wash out, and I put them with a high pressure washer right between these pans, and I went over the shoes, and I messed up their looks. They still work perfect. So I had to go get another pair as soon as I got here. We bought 4 or 5 pairs, I think, yesterday of mongrel boots. So my boys, and for 2 pair for me, and 1 each for the boys. So anyway, those things about culture are ways to really connect. So let's continue here, and let's see. Oh, I have several of those, yeah. Let's see what happened here with our screen. Can somebody help me here? I'm going to plug and replug it. Let's see if this is it. We there? Where did our help go? I hate to restart this. Is it off up there? Oh, there we go. There's a green button here now. Do you see it on there now? Yep. Okay, because you have to see this next picture. This is a dreadful thing for an American that I'm putting up on the screen, for most Americans. If we get it here. I don't know how long that takes to come on, but it is on here now. It's on there. There we go. I'm getting some kind of a... Okay, well, I can tell you what I have here on the screen. Yeah, I did that once. Let's see if it'll automatically... But I have to show you this dreadful picture for an American. Okay. There we go. Yeah, that one I turned back on here, and it seemed to work. Okay. Well, here's the picture I have up on the screen, and it's a picture of Marmite. We could put Vegemite on the screen too, but this is not a taste that is a natural thing for American taste buds. Oh, it's coming now here? Okay. Let's see if I go there. There's a couple options here on this. Well, I think we're there. Look at this guy. It's crazy about it. So, is this an English guy here? So, for Avanist, it's Vegemite, right? No? Marmite's the Avanist. And the Vegemite's the... That's a British one. Well, I'll tell you what. It amazes Australians. The Australians like to see an American come by and put some on their Marmite on their bread, right? And then they laugh because you put too much on, right? I've learned with the avocado and a little tomato, right? Just a little touch of it right across. It's delicious. So we actually have in our home and we use it. I use it. in any case. But for culture or for my students, I actually take this to class with a little toothpick and have each of them try. And there are mixed reviews, right? But it's part of culture, and it's a way to connect with people that way. So here we are, again, coming back to this idea of connecting with secular people, using culture as a way to do it. We're at the beach. We have a freshwater beach there close to our house on Lake Michigan. And we like to go there with our children. Children are a great connector. You know, they're not inhibited by whether somebody's churched or unchurched, right? They just know if somebody's a nice kid or not, right? So our children are playing really well together there on the beach, playing in the sand. And so my wife makes a comment, wow, our kids are playing so well together. Now, I had been listening, and she, of course, you know, confirmed that and thought it was great how well they got along. But I had been listening, and I heard an accent. And so I had an idea that this lady probably was from somewhere else outside of Michigan. And she was Caucasian. And she was, when she answered my question, I asked this question right here. Her mom particularly had a strong accent, didn't seem like she knew a lot of English even. So I simply asked the question, where are you guys from? And then she answered, Chicago. Now Chicago's just across the lake. That was not the answer I was hoping for. So what do I do now? What's your background before Chicago? Okay. Before that. Is the cultural connection important enough to keep working with it a little bit till we get the opportunity to connect that way? Now, here's one thing we have to worry about in the States is they may wonder if you work for immigration. If you ask too many questions, so you have to be a little sensitive on that question. But for most people, you know, culture is something that they really like to connect with, right? Do we have any Tongans here in the room? Okay, yes, right here. Samoans, do we have Samoans? Any Samoans? Yeah, I had some Samoans that I enjoyed working with there in the Canberra area when I was there. Yeah, it's a lot of. So you have some cultural mix. You have a number of different backgrounds. You have a lot of Asians that have moved into Australia, right? And the larger cities tend to have a little more cultural mix than some of the rural areas. But there are opportunities to connect with people culturally. So she says she's from Chicago, and I want to go further than that. But there happened to be something I knew about Chicago. Chicago has a very high population of a Caucasian group that is from another part of the world.
Poland.
Look at that. Who said that? Oh. Any Poles here? Any Polish folk here? Look and see how they knew it, yeah? Man, I was glad I knew that because I knew it was going to be worth pursuing just a little bit with her, right? The second largest population outside of Warsaw is in Chicago. Can you believe that? Huge, but they have a museum there. You've been to Chicago, right?
Right, restaurants.
Yeah. So in any case, this is going to be a great connecting point because one of my closest friends is from Poland. Last name, Grzegorzewicz. Yeah. Oh, Darius' parents, look at that. Yes, absolutely. I remember you guys for sure. Darius, and don't quote me outside of this room, is the most popular teacher at the seminary, their son. You know why? One of the reasons why. He memorizes all his students' names before they ever come to class. And as they walk in the door, he shakes their hand and greets them by name. And he'll have classes of 40 students, and he does this. Incredible. He's taking a personal interest in them. People love him for that, right? When you can call people by their name. It's powerful. He's an excellent teacher as well. But anyway, we sit on a committee together about curriculum reviews, so we have some fun times. A good man. So in any case, she did fess up that they're from Poland originally, and so we got to talk about some Polish food, right, and some of the soups that you guys make, and you know they immediately get excited talking about these things. What's the chance we're going to see Monica again? She's about 2 hours away where she lives, but we go to Chicago once in a while. It seems that we found out they had a beach house there, so it seems that if we want to have contact with her, there's a good chance we could do it again. What's the excuse to get back together again? The kids, you got it, right? Hey, we should get our kids together again. Totally secular person. That's a great opportunity, right? So let's get together with our kids. Well, that was the end of the summer, and sometimes we forget about things, right? Follow-up's important when we want to connect with secular people. And we didn't follow up. The next summer, early in the summer, we're driving home. My wife gets a phone call. Hey, it's Monica from the beach. We're shocked. We're like, what? Here she made contact with us. And so we said, hey, let's get together. Come over to our house for a meal. And so we invited her to our home. And of course, somebody unchurched, when they come to your home, what do they bring with them? Bottle of wine, you got it right. So here comes a bottle of wine to our house, right? And anyway, we were able to avoid. We didn't think that's something that Jesus wants us to do, to connect with secular people. So we were able to kind of slip that off to the side, and they figured out we didn't drink, but it didn't bother them. And it was a great time we had together. But it began because we took an interest in their culture. They're from Poland. Here's the new one. This is the new one. Okay? Jot this down. This may be a new idea for you. Ask a secular person for a favor. I think sometimes we think when we're trying to bring people to Jesus that we need to do something for them. And we make them feel like we have something that we have to give them or do for them, which implies that we're better than they are. Okay? Now, it's true, if we have Christ, we have a peace that they don't have. We have all sorts of things that they don't have. But when you ask somebody for a favor, that means they have something that you like that they can give. And people like to be able to do something as well, not simply always be given something, right? Asking for a favor is a great way to level the playing field of the relationship, where they're not feeling like you're always doing something for them, but they can do something for you. There's a lady here in Australia that we're friends with, a secular lady. She loves making quilts. I asked her if she could make a quilt for my wife. She sent me patterns, ideas of which pattern I wanted. She loves making. I said, I don't want you to go to any expense to do this. I'll pay for the materials. But you're so good at this. I would love for you to make a quilt for my wife. Her daughter moved to Detroit, which is 3 hours from our house, came over to our house for a meal, spent some time with us at our home. Again, these are the kind of connections you begin to make when you look at ways to really relate to people this way. So I want to share a little bit about Jackie and Cindy. We moved to a farm, and let me see where we're at time-wise here. Okay, we're done at 4:30, right? Okay. We moved to a farm in Texas, 15-acre farm. And if you're a good farmer, you need to have farm cats, right? To keep down the mouse population. And here, you know, the snakes are a problem, aren't they? In the farm areas. I mean, that's just that. Yeah, the snakes will keep the mice down instead of the cats. And they'll eat the cats too, right? I'll tell you what. We did have copperheads on our farm there in Texas, and we killed a number of them. Hang on. I accidentally pressed that button there. There we go. This will come back now. I think we're okay. There we go. So, this particular family had a sign up that said free kittens, okay? Now, here's my immediate thought as we drove into this driveway. What's the chance we're going to see them again? Right around as often as we want, pretty much, as often as they'll welcome us. They're neighbors, right? So I think when we have these interactions with secular people, we need to be thinking, is this a one-time conversation? And if so, can we help them get the next step in their life where they want to go? Or will there be opportunity for repeated interactions with the individual? Well, this guy, as we drove into their driveway, I consciously, with the Holy Spirit, said, Lord, do you want something more from this relationship than just a free kitten? In other words, God, what do you want to do with this friendship? Because this is going to be our neighbor around the corner, right? So they invite us to come in their house. Hey, we just moved in around the corner. We'd like to get a kitten from you, a couple kittens maybe. Well, it's an interesting thing how the cats worked out, because they actually ran away as soon as we got home and ran back to their house. But the friendship we got started. So, you know, one of the things I want to ask him is, you know, what do you guys, you know, what do you do here? I mean, what's your farm for? I said, we raise organic vegetables. We sell to all these, you know, high-end markets. So all these, you know, and we you know, kind of grow them all year. And I said, you know what? I love gardening, but you know, I tried here in Texas, and I was gone for a week, and everything died. You know, you have to keep a lot of water on it and stuff. But I said, you know, I would love some help to know how to garden in Texas. He said, I'll be back just a minute. So he leaves the room and comes back with all these bags of seeds, you know, organic bulk seeds that they bought, and start, you know, do you like this? Do you like that? And starts giving me all these seeds. simply because I asked him if he could help me learn about gardening. And then he says, do you have a garden plot that you've tilled up? I said, no, I don't. He said, well, I'll be over on my tractor. When do you want to do that? So he comes over to my house and tills up my garden for me. Can you believe it? And we plant a cantaloupe. We plant all sorts of things. My wife, she brought a pie over for my wife, I think it was, and we invited them in for a meal. And this began a relationship that went back and forth for a number of years of just going, dropping by their place, how's it going, you know, and asking them about their gardening. But it began by asking a favor. Can you teach me about gardening? I'd like to learn more about it. Rather than here, I'm here to share something with you that you need in your life. Started by them giving me an opportunity, something that they're experts in, that they're passionate about, right? Does that make sense? Hopefully it's a new idea to begin thinking through how you can do this with secular people. So, maybe a year and a half later, I walk way up on their property. There's multiple gates, and I remember seeing a big snake there one time as well. But they have this pond that they fill up with water that they use to irrigate their fields with, and they have a well that pumps into it constantly because we get droughts in Texas. And I noticed their water level is very low. And as I walked to them in their upper field there, I said, hey, Jackie and Cindy, how's it going? They said, Tom, we have a major problem. If we don't get rain, we're going to lose our crops. Here's the opportunity. Right? Here's the opportunity. A little scary, right? But I said, Jackie and Cindy, we need to pray to the God of heaven that he'll send you rain. Now, we built up a relationship of trust over time here. That can't be the first conversation. And it's a little scary. What if this prayer is not answered? And yet, I believe the Bible says that God wants to answer those kind of prayers, particularly when it involves somebody believing in him, right? And making a believer of somebody. So I said, Jack and Cindy, they actually held hands with me right out in the field, and we prayed to the God of heaven for rain. Now, the next couple of weeks, next several weeks, as I traveled and spoke in different churches, my daughters would make prayer requests. We want rain for Jackie and Cindy Morrison for their farm. And they kept making this request every time we went places. And so people would pray for them, didn't know them, but would pray for them that God would send them rain. It was about a month later, I went back to their property, walked up there, and they were all smiles. And I said, you know, how's it going? They said, Tom, you can stop praying for rain now. They said, we got so much rain. They said, but it came at the right time. And because of when it came, we've actually had a bumper crop this year. So I said, you know who we need to praise for that, right? We need to praise the God of heaven for sending you rain. We need to thank him for it. So this became the spiritual connecting point, built of a relationship that started with simply asking for a favor. Yes?
In commenting on John chapter 4, which is the woman at the well, Ellen White makes the comment that asking a favor opens the door.
Yes. Can you give me a drink? Yeah. And again, we're looking at different methods, and this is one method I think is quite effective. Let me share one more example of it from one of the most secular countries in the world, and that is Finland, right? Beautiful country, very, very secular. We were checking into a hotel, one of these ones where you had to punch in a code at the door. It wasn't staffed, and it was kind of a little apartment place. And we didn't have enough because we had our children with us and my wife's parents and so on. We didn't have enough bedding. So I went in search in the, you know, the dungeons areas of the building there to see if I can find somebody to get us more sheets and pillows and all this. That's a pretty normal request. And so these guys brought them up to us. And then I simply asked for a favor. I said, you know, guys, we just arrived here. Where could we find a grocery store? And they said, you know, we're getting off work here in a few minutes. We can take you to the grocery store. We can walk you right by it. Very nice, right? I said, man, guys, that would be awesome. Where should we meet? And so we met up downstairs. So we're walking along the street there. And this is kind of what Paul did with Athens, you know, where he saw this, monument to this unknown God. I see this building up ahead, and I suspect it's a church, but I'm not certain. So I said, it's a beautiful building. I said, hey, guys, what's that building up above there? We're coming up to? They said, so that's a Christian church. Now, you ask about whether we should, when sometimes we say we're a pastor or not. I said, you know, I'm a professor, and I teach about how to grow churches and so on. And, you know, I'm a Christian, you know, so this is interesting, it's a Christian church. And he said, you know, I'm not anything, but I'd like to learn more about Christianity. again started with him doing something for me, taking me to find a grocery store. Because I accepted and was willing for him to do something for me, he was willing to ask of me something. And so this one's a great opportunity, right? There's a Bible study right there. I mean, this is a completely secular guy. But he's ready for a Bible study, right? Let's sign him up. When can we start to help you learn more about Christianity, right? So it's an open door there, but it began again by asking for a favor. I want to look at one last category, and I actually have quite a bit of material in this particular area that we may not have time to cover. Perhaps we do it another time. We can cover the whole topic. I want to share with you my premise to start. But let me begin by asking you a question. How many here believe that one of the spiritual gifts is hospitality? Just raise your hand up. Okay. I'm going to assert that is incorrect. And I want to challenge you to go back to your Bibles and look at the passages related to spiritual gifts and see if you find hospitality listed among the spiritual gifts. The study I have done says that it's a nearby neighbor. It's in verses that are nearby to the spiritual gift list, but it's not actually in the spiritual gift list. It is something that all Christians are to be engaged in, not a spiritual gift for a select few. Does it come more naturally for some than for others? Yes, absolutely. By personality, it comes easier for some than it does for others. But the scripture teaching seems to indicate that this is an area that we're all supposed to grow in. And particular mentions hospitality toward strangers. When you look at the biblical text, when you take the Greek word and start to exegete it, it's hospitality towards strangers even that seems to be a big priority. And even scripture says, do not be forgetful to entertain strangers, for some have entertained angels unawares. Do you think that's counsel to just those that have the gift of hospitality? Or is that counsel for all Christians? So I really want to challenge you. When you look at hospitality verses, they're listed next to things like love and prayer. And all these things are all Christians are supposed to do, and yet somebody put it on a list of spiritual gifts and let a lot of people off the hook and said, you know, that's a gift that some people have. I don't have it, so I don't have to do it. And yet that is not the teaching of Scripture on it, okay? I have a strong conviction. I've studied it in detail. In fact, there's one verse I still had a question on in 1 Peter. And so I went to a Greek professor there at the seminary. I said, I need to know here, does this transition between these verses where it talks about hospitality here, it transitions to a spiritual gift passage. Is this transition joining those together, or is it a separate connection here? Are they not connected? And he said the spiritual gift one, the way it's written is in the plural. It applies to the whole church. The spiritual gift one starts by referring to some people. Consistent all through. Check it out. I want to challenge you in that way. This is something we're all to grow in. It's not saying that we're all going to be there naturally, but we should all make an effort in this area of hospitality. And I believe the reason why is this is one of the best ways. Ellen White says it is the key to unlock your neighbor's heart. This is the key. This one trumps the other three. When you have unchurched people to your home, spending time in your home, you are showing them Christianity in action. And we're going to look at a few passages and some things that will really illustrate this. But let me begin by sharing something that happened to us with some unchurched people, secular people. You have Craigslist here in Australia, right?
Gumtree.
It's called Dumtree.
Gumtree.
Okay, Gumtree. I can. I'm glad it's not called Dumtree. Gumtree's okay. I can live with that one. All right. So the similar illustration would be Gumtree, right? Okay. Here we go. So, you know, I like to look for cars when I'm buying cars on Craigslist, and that's where I sell my cars as well. But at the same time, when we were living there in the country, we needed a new van. And so we found a van for sale on Craigslist in a suburb. You know, this is a city the size of Sydney, Dallas-Fort Worth, maybe even a little bigger. A suburb about an hour drive away. The price for the vehicle, the van, was $4,100. Very cheap. Had a cracked windshield. And anyway, we went and got it, and as soon as we saw it there, I said, you know, Do you know anybody who repairs windshields, windscreens, right? Do you know anybody who repairs windscreens? They said, oh, yeah, we know this guy. Let me give him a call. So he calls this guy by the name of Mario. He said, hey, Mario, got a cracked windscreen here. Can you come and fix it? He says, I'm tied up. I'll go to their house tomorrow. So he's going to drive over an hour to come to our house to fix the windscreen. He got the model of the vehicle so he could bring the right thing down. He came down with his wife. And so they pull into our driveway. We're out in this, you know, the country there, and they're working our windscreen. My wife comes out, and first connection we like to use with people is what? Culture, right? Where are they from? And they're from Central America. And have you tried Brazilian food? My wife being Brazilian. So we're making all these connections with the idea, hey, we need to have you over for some Brazilian food sometime to our home. So that was the connecting point with it. He gave us a bunch of cards. He's a good, you know, good businessman, and left. Well, we didn't follow through. Again, follow through is important when we work with secular people, right? We have to follow through. We got busy. We forgot about it. But God has a way to bring things to our remembrance. If this did not really happen, I would question the authenticity of this story. But I know for a fact that it happened. We went to get our next vehicle, a truck, like this. We found it for sale in the same suburb, which is over an hour from our house in a big metro area, same suburb, for the same price, $4,100, with the same problem, a cracked windscreen. I said, okay, God, I get the message. You want us to connect with Mario. I mean, it was, I couldn't believe this thing. So I give Mario a call even before we go to pick the truck up. I say, I'm picking up this truck. Can I meet you? And we can get the windscreen. So first thing I did, because God got my attention now, right? I said, Mario, we need to get together for a meal. Let's get our calendars out. Let's get our families together. So Mario ends up bringing his family over to our house. So here they are. This was right before I became a vegan. So you can see that we're enjoying some very unhealthy things there. Having a great time with their family. You know, my boys here and their kids, my wife over here. And they're from Central America. What kind of thing do you think they enjoy doing in terms of sports?
Soccer.
Yeah, there we go. So the guys get out in the front yard there with their girls too and enjoy some soccer. Their teenage daughter ends up going upstairs to hang out with our daughter. And when they left, she said, man, she said a lot of bad words. I said, well, she doesn't know. She doesn't know any different. You know, that's you know, we need to share Jesus. We need to be friends, right? And sometimes it's a little messy, right? But as we were outside playing, Brenda opened up her heart to my wife and talked about how she escaped into Mexico from Central America, and she got into a life of selling herself to be able to support her children. She met this man who she'd married, but their oldest daughter was not his, and they were having lots of problems in the relationship because of the older daughter. She just opened her heart because we opened our home, right? And I want to share with you a quote in a moment that really illustrates this very well. But here it is. Well, here there's two I'll be sharing actually right here. The mission of the home extends beyond its own members. The Christian home is to be an object lesson illustrating the excellence of the principles of life. Such an illustration will be more a power for good in the world, far more powerful, this is a point I want to bring here, than any sermon preached, is the influence of a true home upon human hearts and lives. More powerful than David Asherick's sermons, all right? Than Dwight Nelson, that's my pastor, right? More powerful than their sermons is what can happen in your home. So let me ask you, is the growth of your church dependent on powerful sermons from the pulpit, or is it more dependent on what happens in your home? The power is what happens in your home. You can have an average preacher, but if you've built relationships with people in their homes, in your home, and drawn them to Christ, they're going to stick around, aren't they? They're going to stick around. It's huge. It's powerful. So what would you just, let's just brainstorm here for a moment. Why would this quote, why would this be said? More powerful than the sermon is what can happen in your home. Give me several reasons why. Okay, why? Okay, they're open to your love.
Yeah.
Okay, good, all right? It's more intimate, isn't it? Good. What else? It's what? It's one-on-one, more personal. Yeah, good. Trust can develop. When you trust somebody to come to your home, it's saying that, you know, I can have trust in you. Yeah. The friendship, absolutely. Everybody has a home, right? Of some sort. Is it easier to invite somebody to come to your home or to go to the church? Which are they more likely to accept? And yet, why are we always going out trying to invite people to come to our church? Let's invite them to come to our home first. Then, when we've won their confidence, let's invite them to go to the church, right? But let's invite them to our home. Let's open up our home. This is, by the way, right here in Australia, in Melbourne. You guys all know Johnny Wong, right? The power of what they're doing is their Friday night home groups. He calls them care groups. They happen with students. I was staying in the home of this particular family, and they opened up their home for a care group on Friday night. And you can see people interacting. They start with food. They have a meal together, and then they spend time studying the Bible together. But it happens in a home setting. Then they take these home groups, and they have them come together as church plants that meet on Sabbath morning. I want to just share a few more principles here. We know this quote so well, Christ's method alone. There's no other method. That's a singular method that's going to give us success. And he doesn't start out with trying to convince people the 28 fundamental beliefs. He starts out by desiring the good of people, mingling with people. We need to be mingling. We need to be interacting where people are at and have those relationship connections. And if you're not comfortable having somebody in your home, invite somebody out for a meal, right? I don't have a home in Australia. I wish I did. But this lady we just met on Friday, I didn't make it here for the meeting Friday night because we had told her we would take her out for a meal. And so Friday afternoon, we're at a restaurant, a Thai restaurant in Sydney, with an unchurched lady that we're friends with, having a meal together. I don't have a home to invite her to here, otherwise we would. And we've invited her to come over to our home in the U.S. when she can travel and come and stay with us in our home. And so you can see, you know, the hugs and wanting to get a picture together. Unchurched people, everybody needs a friend, right? Unchurched people need, I don't care how rich they are, how poor they are, what culture they're from, how educated or uneducated, everybody needs a friend. And when we show ourselves friendly this way, people will respond, but we need to mingle in order for that to happen. We don't have to serve the whole enchilada. We can take a relationship and develop it over time, right? Another one here. We need to avoid the insider language. Conduct yourselves with wisdom toward outsiders, making the most of the opportunity. We need to make the most of every opportunity. Let your speech always be seasoned, always be with grace, seasoned as it were with salt, so that you may know, look at this right here, how you should respond to each person. That sounds to me like it's something that God's going to give us wisdom, right? The Holy Spirit will tell us how we need to do that. The next concept here I want to share, these are just some principles as we wrap up. We've already shared all four areas, just touching on some principles as we close. So the first area was coaching, asking questions, right? The second area, connect with culture whenever possible. The third area, ask a favor. The fourth one, hospitality. Opening up our home, opening up our heart in that way. Here's another concept, and that is that our job is to add some drips to the bucket. Drips to the bucket. What does that mean? When a person makes a decision, and finally makes a decision for Jesus, there are usually a number of people that have been involved in that process of them getting to that decision. It's not just one conversation that got them there, right? It may be one conversation that adds that last drop to the bucket where the bucket overflows and the person makes their decision. Your job is to add some more drops to that bucket. It's the Holy Spirit's job for that bucket to eventually overflow, right? So you don't have to fill up the whole bucket. Your job is to add some drops along the way. I was getting my hair cut in a different place than I normally go, but it was near Andrews University. And as I sat down, I didn't have a chance to do any coaching with this lady, coaching questions I would have liked to, because she wanted to talk the whole time. But it was she was like asking me questions. That's what she was. She was grilling me. And I didn't know what she was trying to do, but you know, where are you from? Well, I'm from Andrews University. What do you do there? Well, I teach there. Where? Andrews University? And I mean, it's just down the road. And I'm thinking, this lady doesn't know what Andrews University is. This is so strange. And then she, you know, keeps asking more and more questions, and finally she asked me a question. I didn't want to answer it. Didn't want to give her a response, because it would have involved me being vulnerable, me being real, me sharing something that I didn't want to share. So I remember a conversation quickly with God. I said, God, should I share or not? Should I answer her question or not? It was a split second, because she's waiting for my response. So I decided to respond and be real with her. As soon as I did, she said, I'm a former Seventh-day Adventist. If I had not been real with her, she never would have been real with me. So we talked further, and she had been disfellowshipped from the Adventist Church. I think because she'd had a child out of wedlock or something like that, and I'm not saying we should do that. I'm not sure that is the best response. By the way, church discipline is biblical. This is a freebie, we'll add here, for two reasons. When somebody is unrepentant and it's public. Those are the only reasons we administer church discipline. Praise God, somebody, when we had the whole Waco thing, the individual that led out in the whole Waco thing, David Koresh, was actually a child and was baptized at the church I pastored in North Dallas. Thank God somebody voted him out of the Adventist Church, right? There's a place for church discipline, but it's for those who are unrepentant and it's public, right? And when a young girl's got him pregnant and is saying, you know, I made a mistake, I want to fix it, I want to make things right, that's not the time for the church to be going, oh, we're going to get you now, right? So we need to be thinking about these things. But anyway, she had been disfellowshipped from the church and she left. However, there had been one young lady that was her age that had stayed in contact with her for years and maintained a friendship with her for years. What was this young lady doing? Drip, 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 adding all sorts of drips to an empty and broken bucket, right? But that bucket started to hold some water. Drip, drip, drip. So she began sharing with me. I said, well, what do you think you need to do? She said, my work schedule is going to be changing, and when it does, I need to go back to church. Overflow the bucket, right? Man, I added just one little drop to the bucket that had been filled up by somebody else. And so our responsibility is going to be faithful to add drips to the bucket as people begin to respond, and the Holy Spirit will give the overflow when that opportunity comes. But I don't think unchurched people, secular people, relate to Christians who act like they've got it all together. Because they know that's not real, right? And yet, Christ does transform us and he does change us. But we don't need to act like we've got our act all together to impress a secular person. They're not impressed by that. They're impressed by somebody who can be genuine, who can be real, who can be authentic. And that's something that they can relate to. All right, next one here. We need to pick the right fruit, right? When somebody's ready for a decision, let's ask for it. We started making appeals for baptism at our Seeds conferences. We do Seeds church planting conferences. All these years I've been leading out in this program, and we have like 12 a year all around the conference and even overseas. Never been asking for baptism decisions, because we're asking for decisions to lead church plants, right? We decided to put on our card, I would like to be baptized, as one of the decisions people can make. And so we handed these cards out. And what happened is, the reason we started doing this is, one of our presenters went to a local church to preach as part of Seeds. And he came back and said he had 11 decisions for baptism. We said, what? You were there talking about church planting and 11 people made a decision to be baptized? Yeah, I just called them for a decision. They came forward. I said, well, now we're here with the whole group. Make another call. So he made another call. 5 more people came forward. We had 16 decisions for baptism simply because we asked. Why? The fruit was ripe and nobody had been asking. So a couple weekends ago, we had one of our presenters, a young man, seminary student. He gave him his cards. Here, you're going to go this preach at this church. And Ben, you're going to be doing this. You're coming up very soon. We're going to have Ben call for baptisms in Canada for us. So anyway, he handed out these cards, this church he went to preach at. And he came back and he had this card. Somebody made a decision for baptism in my sermon. So anyway, he was so excited. And he said the biggest thing that he learned is that we need to ask people to make decisions. We need to simply invite. When the time is ready, the Holy Spirit will call them to make that decision. Let's ask them. Let's not be afraid to ask them for decisions. I was pastoring a church. The first year I was there, we had 45 baptisms without any public evangelistic meeting. Simply by calling people to make a decision for baptism. The Holy Spirit had ripened the people already. And they were sitting there in the congregation. We just invited them to make decisions. And we didn't even make some big altar call where they had to come front. I just had a card. Here are the baptism dates. If you like one of them, check it. Simple. Ask people for decisions. Don't be afraid to ask for decisions. You can do it in a culturally appropriate way. But still, Scripture tells us we need to ask people for decisions because there's ripe fruit, and if you don't pick ripe fruit, what happens? It rots, right? It rots. So we need to pick the ripe fruit. That's another principle when we work with secular people we need to be aware of. Is somebody's decision, is it a baptism, or at baptism, is that a birth or is it a graduation? What does Scripture teach? It's a birth. And yet, the way we treat it sometimes, particularly in some countries, I'm not sure how it is here in Australia, but we treat it like a graduation. Like we want to make sure we can trust these people, that they believe everything we believe, that they've taken certain things off, that they've stopped doing certain things, right? I believe that people grow in Christ when they're in the proper community, right? And that we need to ask people to make a decision to follow Christ and follow His church, join His church, right? But some of these other things, the Holy Spirit needs to be the one to convict. And when we try to play the role of the Holy Spirit and bring conviction to people, hey, you shouldn't be listening to this or you shouldn't be doing that, I think we're trying to run ahead of the Holy Spirit's work. And let's let the Holy Spirit work on people's lives and think about a graduation versus a birth. Now, I think we can stop the recording now because I want to say something very radical, okay? So let me take this off. We'll go off record here, okay? And your president may not invite me back for saying this, but that's okay.
Let me share this with you. There's a reason we do it, and that's because we want to make sure we have a teaching that is that we want to be pure in the way we have our. And we have a bunch of crazy people running around some places, and you don't want just somebody going off and baptizing people that's not a solid Adventist, right? And this is why we did it. But in the process of doing this, I think we've heard mission. And what I try to do as a pastor is if there was a layperson that was involved in leading somebody to Jesus, they were there in the tank with me baptizing that person together. Every church can at least do that much, and nobody's going to have a problem with that. But biblically, all disciples are to baptize. So here's what a friend of mine started doing. Some of you know Gary Blanchard, right? He's been over here. Did he share with you what he did with this? He got in a little trouble. One of his church members sent a picture off to the conference and said, what are all these lay people baptizing for? The church he went to was half empty. And here now the church is filled overflowing, and lay people are baptizing. Well, one of the members thought this isn't proper, so they sent the picture to the conference president and said, what's our pastor doing here, having all these lay people baptized? Well, here's what he said. He said, first of all, they're the ones that did the Bible studies. And he made a sport illustration, and the Super Bowl's coming on Monday here, right? So I'll share with you the sport illustration he used. He said, when the pastor's the one that baptizes, it's like the coach calling timeout when the ball's at the 1 yard line. He said, okay guys, you did a great job getting it down here. Now I'm gonna run across and make the touchdown. That's what it's like when a pastor baptizes and the member's the one that's done all the studies, right? So here's what he said to the conference president. He said, I have to go for the last Bible study and make sure that the person has covered everything that needs to be covered so that they're prepared for baptism. I just want to double check that. The second one is I need to be present there for the baptism when it takes place. This is protecting from running off, everybody running off and doing their own thing. He said the third thing is I want that person to have taken a discipleship class from me so they know how to disciple the person after they're baptized. He said if all three of those things are done, anybody in our church that wants to can baptize. They've done all three of those things. Pretty cool, huh? I'll have to tell you what. baptizing, that is the greatest privilege we can have as a Christian, to see someone make that decision for Jesus. And when lay people start to experience that, man, it puts a fire in you like you would not believe. And it helps the church grow. So I think we've made an error in this area that's hurt our mission a little bit. And I think there's some ways to correct it and still have the accountability we need. Yes? Oh, the follow-up for the discipleship? Well, there's a couple things we could say on that. One is that healthy churches are sticky churches, which means people stay in churches that are healthy. And that's why I'm so glad that this conference is involved in natural church development. It's an objective measure of the health of your church so that you know to improve the weak areas, because when the church is healthy, people will stay. We can't disciple them if they don't stay. That's the point I want to make. First of all, we need to know they're going to keep coming, and they're not going to keep coming if the church is sick. And I've been to some churches in Australia that are sick. In a different conference that I worked in, when I was here, I was in South New South Wales, and there's some good churches there. I remember one church, they looked over to me, and they were really concerned whether I was ordained or not before I got up to preach. So they didn't know whether to introduce me as a pastor or not, because they would only call me pastor if I'd been ordained. I said, yes, I'm a pastor. I'm using American terminology here, but anyway, we call pastor, right? You don't have to be ordained first, and that's what they wanted to know. But that's not a church that's going to keep people. You're going to be running people off when we get caught up on these little things. So be a healthy church, and I'll just make this one illustration. We want to be a movement as Adventists, right? A movement has to have momentum. The illustration, you have the 10 pin. You play 10 pin here at bowling. You know the illustration? I don't know if Adventists play that here. They do, okay. You know, those bowling alleys have cleaned their act up in recent years. It's not too bad of a place usually, depending on which one you go. But in any case, there's one of these boys that we want to adopt, a six-year-old. They both love to bowl, but the kid, it doesn't have enough momentum to get it down. It doesn't matter if it starts out straight, it's going to end up in the gutter one way or the other, because there's no momentum. The momentum of the Seventh-day Adventist Church is evangelism, is soul winning. And when our church stays focused on soul winning, on evangelism, we're going to get the ball down the middle, right? We're going to have success, we're going to have a strike. When we start going left or right into issues, we're going to have gutter balls, one after another. The issues can take us off. I don't care whether it's to the left or to the right. If we get caught up in issues, we're going to lose our focus, and we're not going to be a movement. So a movement focuses on winning people to Jesus. And so this is where our churches need to be focused. Our mission's there. And yet our budgets in our churches, you know what? We spend 99% on ourselves. And we say we're about lost people. What business would succeed if it only spends 1% or 5% on the customer and the other 95%, 99% on the employees? Right? It's not going to succeed. This is one of the keys. I heard the comment with great interest about tithe for your conference, because I was stewardship and church planning director in Texas for 9 years. We were hiring pastors when other conferences were laying them off, because our finances were good, because we're about evangelism and church planting. That's where we put the focus. And when the members of the church see that our church is serious about what the church is supposed to do, they get excited. Right? And you know what the biggest fuel to motivate church members is? Pastors that are here, leaders, elders that are here, change lives. When you see a life that's been changed because of the ministry of your church or because of the ministry of your church members, there's nothing greater to motivate you. That is the biggest motivation anybody can have. What we're doing is actually making a difference. And that's what causes people to want to give more, when they see people's lives being changed. You want to give knowing it's going to make a difference. If you're not sure it's going to make a difference, you're doing it simply out of obligation. That's definitely not producing a cheerful giver. But we must disciple people, which means they need to have friendships in the church. In the first 6 to 12 months, they've got to be connected immediately, or they're going to leave very, very quickly. And so, you know, this needs to be intentional. It's not going to happen just because we hope it'll happen. We need to have these new people to our home. We need to get them involved in ministry right away. That's part of discipling. Giving something for people to do. What I like to refer to that as, we need shovel-ready jobs, right? This is President Obama came into office with a big, you know, he wanted to have shovel-ready jobs. What do you mean by that? He wanted to put people to work right away, right? And there's something that anybody can do that walks into your church, pretty much. And you want to be careful with some of the child protection things and all these kind of things. But you need to put people to work. That's part of discipling them. On-the-job training. disciples, they went out. They learned as they went, you know? And that's part of the dependence on God that's established. So that's one of the best ways to disciple people. Get them involved right away. Have a healthy church where they want to stay, that's serious about the mission, what the church is about. Put them to go fishing for their friends right away. A lot of people stay in the church, the last unchurched friends they have. So we need to put people fishing right away. All right, we'll take time for a few questions, comments, as we wrap up. Yes. Sorry, Hendrick.
We're really blessed to have the Arise College of Evangelism. So our
yes.
Three baptisms at Gosford have been based on young people from Arise.
Yep.
And they've studied with those young people. So when we've done the baptism, those young people are co-baptized with them on the other side.
That's awesome.
That's a really good compromise between pastors.
Yeah. Oh.
On the day, it's just been so exciting.
Yeah. And here's what I try to progress is the next step. You know what the next step to that one is? Is you stand outside the tank and say, "We now baptize you." You know, that was just a small step further the right direction, right? Not that much harder to do. You're there and say, "We now baptize you," and they do it. Jesus himself didn't baptize. It was his disciples that baptized, right?
Gave us permission to do that.
That's awesome. Yeah. Yeah, I've been preaching it for a while, and Gary did it well. I had my elders baptizing, and I got permission for that. But you have an awesome conference president here. I tell people all around the world, I think you've got the best conference president of anybody that I've run across in the world field. And there's some good ones. There's some very good conference presidents I know. You are really blessed. He's an innovator. He's as solid of an Adventist as they come, and yet he's very open to new ideas. Great man. You're blessed, and he's followed a great leader. Yeah. So.
You forgot John was here for a while, didn't you?
Yeah, there we go. Yes.
Yeah, I think so. It's a conference not perfect, a pastor not perfect, I not perfect.
Yeah.
So end of time, we need to God give us every one different lead way for the shared gospel. But I think for the baptizing all these things, have to, even I can lead the people, so many people, Holy Spirit,
yeah.
So many people come to God and so set up home church. So best to do, have to ask him, invite the pastor and come to the baptizing.
Yeah.
Why? Because in the Bible, oil make the ointment.
Yeah. So that's, let's... Yeah, that's an Old Testament model. The New Testament model is the priesthood of all believers. All believers are ministers according to the New Testament. However, yeah?
We're suffocating in the open windows.
Okay, I think we're about done here. We just have a couple more minutes, so we'll wrap it up. In the New Testament, it teaches the priesthood of all believers, which means that all members are ministers. Okay? Right. Yeah. Yeah. This is where we've gotten to as a church, but we've not really fully embraced what it means to be the priesthood of all believers. And we still have set the clergy at a place where it's not proper in terms of how the New Testament teaches it. When I first baptized, I was so concerned because I said, you know, here, I have mistakes, I have problems in my life. Who am I to be baptizing somebody? But there's a quote where Ellen White talks about, it's not the person that's being baptized that God considers when somebody's baptized, it's the decision of the person being baptized.
That's right.
It's what God is looking at. So it really doesn't matter who's doing that baptism in terms of, from God's perspective, it's the decision of the person that's being baptized. So anyway, you can do what you're comfortable with. I like the middle ground of somebody in the tank. But again, this is a way to bring some joy as far as and mission as well. But that wasn't our subject for today. That was a piece I covered with the microphone off. Okay, anybody else that has an area you want to touch on? All right, yes?
Just a comment on baptism again.
Okay.
I was over at Spears Point some years ago. It was a cool day, our family was there. But we noticed a church group of some sort, and they were doing a baptism. They just, two of them, took the person to be baptized and
Yep.
Get them under the water. It was quite an interesting way of doing it.
Yeah, yeah. We don't know that backwards is the way. I mean, it's, you know, it's full immersion is what we know. Yeah. Well, very good. I think I'll probably want to conclude at this point right here, and then we'll pray together. The key for any of this is to pray for divine appointments. God will intersect our lives with people he wants us to connect with, right? And if God intersects our lives, that means he trusts us to have those conversations for him, right? So I wish for my own life, and I want to challenge you for your own life, that you daily pray, God, do you have a divine appointment for me today? Help my eyes to be open for what appointment you have for me. And I believe when our members are praying this, when we as church members are praying this, that God will use this to grow his church. Because he knows where the ripe fruit is at. He knows for the people that are ready to talk, that are ready to have these conversations. And he'll make those intersections in our lives happen. I've had some crazy opportunities that God has placed right in front of me when I've had that prayer. I remember one time I was driving past, God, I prayed this, and I was driving past a cemetery, and I saw this guy alone standing out by a graveside. Holy Spirit told me, pull over, talk with that guy. I didn't do it. By the time I stopped my car to turn around and come back, he had pulled out. If I had gone when the Holy Spirit prompted me, I would have been there. And I wonder how many opportunities we miss. How many top opportunities have I missed? Simply because, like the disciples who went to that Samaritan village, they went for a buffet, right? They went to get something to eat, and here's this whole Samaritan village that's ready, and they didn't share with anybody. They didn't invite anybody back to come meet Jesus. And yet, here's a whole village that's ready. So let's pray for God to keep our eyes open and to make these divine appointments for us. Let's conclude with prayer. Dear Lord, we're challenged. I think of my own life, how many opportunities I've missed for spiritual conversations. Lord, this is what you want from us. You want us to be salt that seasons this world for you. This is a country filled with secular people that don't know you, that don't have the hope that we have. Lord, I want to pray for each one of us here that you will give us divine appointments. My family and I are only here for a brief time on this trip. I want to pray that you'll give us divine appointments for you, that we can have spiritual conversations with people that will help move them a step closer to you, that will add some drips to the bucket of making that decision for you. And Lord, help us not to be afraid to call for decisions when it's time to pick the fruit. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Can we put our hands together?